good morning. My name is Candace Stansel. I get to serve as your Chief Equity Officer for the City of Atlanta. And it is my privilege to welcome you to International Day of the Girl. Let me hear it. Man. I'm a little emotional as I stand here because it has been quite a journey to get to this day. And so I'm just going to use my remarks because we want to make sure we're on time and enjoying this moment and this special treat. We've got something in store for y'all this morning that's going to be amazing. Listening, laughing, learning. And before we get into it, I want to see who's in this room really quickly. So if you, it's called sit down, stand up. So if I call something that aligns to you, I want you to get up for 2 minutes, right? We're going to do this really quickly. So if you're in a sixth graders, let me see you stand up. Cheer, yeah, look, woo! Seventh graders in the building, hey! Eighth graders, come on, who's gonna be the loudest? Eighth graders, let me see you. Woo, up! Eighth graders, are we too cool? We're too cool? All right, you're in the ninth grade. Let me see you, let me hear you. Ninth graders, woo! Right in the middle of this high school time, 10th graders, let me see you. Woo, up! Look, they're ready. They are ready. All right, juniors, come on, let's see what you got, juniors. 11th graders, woo! Now I know this group is ready. They're counting down. Seniors, let me see you and hear you. Woo! All right, class of 2025, we see y'all, we see you. We're so glad that you all are here today. We'll get to know y'all a little bit more in a bit. But we are here because International Day of the Girl, which is held annually on October 11th, as defined by the United Nations, is dedicated to promoting girls' rights and highlighting the unique challenges they face globally. This day emphasizes the importance of empowering girls, advocating for their education, health, safety, and addressing issues such as gender-based violence and inequality. We are excited to celebrate with you in this special experience of being a girl in this world. So I wanna take a moment and introduce you to a few people who are in the room with us. And I wanna say first, thank you before I bring up the first person to the Georgia Public Broadcasting family. They have been instrumental in making this happen. This is the studio you're in, we're so grateful. I'll give a special shout out to Mimi Ricks, Emily Hackshaw, and Nikita Ingram, who have been partners in purpose for today. And I welcome Bert Wesley Huffman, the president of Georgia Public Broadcasting.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Candace. I'm getting this ready for the mayor. So thank you and welcome to GPB. Anybody been here before? Is this the first time? Okay, wow. Well, this is your house and we are glad to have you here. In addition to being PBS and NPR for the state of Georgia, we also like to tell Georgia stories, and that's your stories. So today, I hope that at this very first Atlanta celebration of the International Day for the Girl, that you find something that inspires you and that you can take something away, that maybe you learn something new, because that's what public media is all about. So we want to say thank you to Atlanta Public Schools and to the Mayor's Office of Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion for coming here to GPB. We are happy to host you anytime. So with that, I'm going to bring up Mayor Dickens.
All right. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. I am thrilled to be here today to celebrate International Day of the Girl. This is an amazing day, and I'm just so excited to be here. 13 years ago, the United Nations adopted a resolution declaring October 11th the International Day of the Girl. The UN wanted to bring attention to the challenges girls face around the globe while also recognizing their human rights. Here in Atlanta, I'm proud to say that we are not just committed to joining this global movement, we are leading by example, fostering an environment where every girl can learn, grow, and thrive. From day one, my administration has committed to creating a citywide culture that values, supports, and sustains the contributions of women and girls. It is a part of our commitment to making Atlanta a city of opportunity for all. And October 11th reminds all of us that we have a responsibility to support and uplift girls in our community. Our theme this year is Ignite Her Future. This in and of itself is a call to action on all of our parts. It is my goal to make Atlanta the place where all girls have access to the tools that foster growth and learning, the place where their support systems are strong, and the place where their dreams are encouraged. The bigger the dream, the better. This is how we are igniting her future, by helping girls realize their full potential. But none of us can do it alone. It takes the combined power of government, private and nonprofit partners, advocates and leaders, and communities to dismantle systemic inequities and barriers to opportunity. That's why we are pleased to have partners who join us in building a more equitable future for all of our bright, bold, and brilliant girls. With the support of these partners and working alongside the Mayor's Women of Atlanta Advisory Council, we are laying the foundation for a more inclusive, supportive, and empowering environment. We want to create opportunities for girls that are accessible, that foster leadership development, and that pair them with strong mentors. We're not here to just celebrate this single day. We are investing in leaders, in innovators, and change makers of tomorrow. So thank you all for being here today. And thank you to the Mayor's Office of Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion, and to GPB Studios for hosting this great event. Happy International Day of the Girl, everybody.
It is so refreshing to have a leader that supports girls here in Atlanta. So thank you, Mayor Dickens. My name is Tahajna Spence, and I serve as the Community Affairs Manager for the Mayor's Office of Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion. We all have stories to tell. For today's girls, our stories struggle to find the best way to be understood. Puppets allow for expression of emotion, description, and compassion through object representation. They provide a safe container to hold and communicate the stories that often encompass our deepest feelings, one step removed. During this workshop, we will be introducing students to the storytellers that live in us all, as we explore puppetry as a form of communication. Rae Kaplan Maxwell is an Atlanta-based actress and puppeteer, as well as the Education Initiatives Manager for the Center for Puppetry Arts. Rae has been teaching puppetry for all styles and ages since 1995 as a private coach and a classroom teacher. Join me to explore puppets. What's your story? Hey, everybody. We've got some intrepid volunteers. We're going to go through a quick little warm-up in a second, but I wanted to welcome you all and welcome all of you. We're so excited to have you here. This is a special day. This is a special event. And I know from being one of you that sometimes we get really caught up in our own stories and we forget how important it is to find common ground in listening to others too. So puppetry is a really great opportunity to have partnership and collaboration as we're telling these important stories. Let me just get a show of hands from everyone in the room. How many people have ever felt like no one understands me? Yeah, me too, right? It's totally normal. That's because we're all individuals and we're all very aware that we have our own individual stories. Sometimes the best way to connect is to find a way to share those stories and work together to tell them. We're gonna do a little bit of that right now. But before we can do puppets, which is a very physical way of telling a story or communicating, we need to kind of
Hello.
Oh, thank you. We need to be able to use our bodies and sometimes not even use our voices. So we want to make sure, though, that we're safe when we do that. And that means we want to treat our bodies carefully and conscientiously. So what we're going to do is a quick little warm-up. Can you girls make a circle with me right here in the center? Make a circle. We'll all just be in a circle. It's okay. You can have your back to the audience. We want to fill in. Make a circle. There you go. Okay. Microphone. All right, so let's take a little bit of a step back so we have a little bit of room. We're just going to shake everything. We're just going to shake it all. We're going to shake it all. You're all welcome to join us if you want to put your seats. That's right. And what we're going to do is we're going to do a countdown. We call a countdown. We're going to count to five. We're going to shake our hands five times. So our right hand, we're going to shake five times and count out loud. Then we're going to shake our left hand five times and count out loud. Then we're going to shake our right foot five times and count out loud. Five times with our left foot, count out loud. Then we're gonna do 4, 4, 4, 4, 3, 3, 3, 3, 2, 2, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1. All right. All right, Mayor Dickens, you ready?
I'm ready.
All right, starting with your right hand, we're gonna shake and count out loud to five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, set. Okay. Now, a lot of puppetry is telling stories through play. And I guarantee that everybody in this room, at one time or another, has picked up a stuffed animal, picked up a Barbie doll, picked up a Beanie Baby or a Beanie Boo, and talked to it, or made it talk. Raise your hand if you've ever done that. Yep. We've got a room full of puppeteers, right? What are the things about a puppet that really make you think it's alive? Like this. This is really a piece of rag, right? It's got a little styrofoam ball in here and some padding, but it's made out of rags. So if I were to pick my pile of rags off the ground, guess what? It's still rags.
Oh.
Wow. Ouch. What did I just do? What I did for you and what you all allowed me to do is a magic trick. We took this thing that has no life to it at all, and we brought it to life right in front of you. We allowed ourselves to believe. We didn't have to. We know this isn't real. We know this is made out of fabric, but we wanted to, right? We wanted to. And sometimes communicating is about finding those points of connection. So we're going to do that here, and often it takes more than one person to do it. I was able to bring this to life a little bit, but if I had had a couple of other helpers with me, we would have been able to do a lot more. In order to work together, though, we need to make sure that we're on the same wavelength. How are we going to do that? Well, let's do one more exercise. Make another circle with me, girls, if you will. Now, this one is going to be a little bit trickier. We're going to need to tune in and really listen. We're going to close our eyes, and we are going to, as a group, try to count to 10, one at a time. So with our eyes closed, when you feel like you are ready or somebody is ready to say the next number, say it. We're going to try and not overlap, okay? And we're going to try and count to 10. So close your eyes, take a deep, and we're going to all take a deep breath together. Exhale. When you're ready, someone can start with the number 1, and we're going to continue one at a time up to 10. Okay, let's start again. Good.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Okay, one more time. We're going to start at 1.
1, 2, 3.
Okay, I lied. One more time. We got it. We got it. We got it.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Yeah! Good job, everybody. All right. Now, we're going to do a little exploration of puppetry. So let's have you three behind this table, you three behind that table. You see you've got a puppet on your table here. We're going to, this puppet requires 3 people per 1 puppet. There are 3 parts of our puppet that we want to really pay attention to. We have the head, so someone is going to need to be the head of our puppet. We have the feet, and one of us is going to need to be the feet of our puppet, okay? And we have the arms, so our third person is going to be the arms. All right, head puppeteer. Please pick up the puppet, holding the neck kind of pinched between your thumb and finger, just like that. And head puppeteer, take a second to get acquainted with this puppet. There are 2 things that this puppet does not have that we as puppeteers need to give it to bring it life. Who can think of 1 thing that all living things have and do that non-living things don't? Yes?
Use its neck.
Use its neck, that's a good suggestion. Even simpler than that?
Like basic emotions, I guess.
Before you can get to basic emotions, what do you need to do as a living organism?
Facial features.
Yep, before you can get to that, more basic. Yes? More basic.
Breathe.
Breathe! Yeah, all of these things were right, but you can't do any of them without a breath. And let me tell you something. If you've never thought about this before, think about it for a second. Every single person in this room, every single person in the world has this in common. We breathe. We breathe. And when we breathe together, we connect. It's as simple as that. Okay, so we are going to use that breath to inform the other people on our team what our puppet is thinking. The head puppeteer is just what it sounds like. You're in charge of the head. What lives in your head? Your brain. So you, head puppeteer, are the brains of the operation. You are going to be making the decisions for your puppet. What is the other thing that's part of the head that allows us to recognize what a faceless puppet might be thinking or doing? How do we know what side of the face is the front, for instance? What part of us do we use to show other people what we're focusing on? Eyes, right. So head puppeteer, to start, holding your puppets just like you are, I want you to, in your head, decide where your eyes are on the puppet, and I want you to have your puppet look around the room a little bit. Just have it look around the room, maybe look at the lighting instruments above us, look at the floor below us. How is that puppet going to focus its sight? It's how it's turning its head. It's how it's holding its body and its height in space. Okay, that's great. Now we've got that started. Now, who our foot puppeteer? Okay, you're going to stand in the middle. So let me move you over to the side. You're going to probably want to get down pretty low, maybe even kneel. And you're going to be exactly that. You're going to be holding the ankles of the puppet, or you know, the knots at the bottom are kind of the ankles. And you're going to be pinching them between your thumb and forefinger. And the head puppeteer, you want to kind of pull up against the feet. So you're going to be holding the feet down, and you're going to be pulling up. This is creating bones. We've just made a skeleton out of a rag, right? We have this give and take of gravity and pressure between two people to now add to this figure we're bringing to life. Okay, so now before we jump on the arms, I want this puppet now who is looking around. Let's have you just tilt, kind of alter your fingers so that you're holding, like let go for a second. Hold from the back of the puppet, so like that. Okay, so now I want the head puppeteer and the foot puppeteer to see if they can move this puppet in the direction the puppet wants to go. How do we do that? Well, we start with the head, and we look, and we walk. Okay. All right. Now, great. Okay. Oh, that puppet just turns its head. So that means the foot puppeteer always has to be watching what that puppet's doing and where that puppet's looking. Okay, good. All right, great. It's getting around. It's looking. Maybe it wants to sit. Maybe it can do that. How would it sit? Yeah, okay. All right. Now, when you let it drop like that, we lose its spine. So you, the head puppeteer, can use your other hand to adjust the waist. So when it sits down, now we have a butt. You made a butt. Important, right, when you sit. Let's see if while you're holding the waist, you can get that puppet to stand back up again. How would you stand up? Yeah, okay, lean forward and stand. Great, wonderful. Okay, pause for a second. Now, of course, we're going to add our third puppeteer on the arms. And you've got it. You're going to be kind of right behind here. So this will be your left hand. Mm-hmm. And then you'll reach around. This will be your right hand. You don't need to necessarily hold the waist the whole time. You can. It's really mostly if you're going to be bending or sitting. But you can always reach in for that. So now what I would like you to try. Great. So you want to kind of hold down by the wrists so that you have as much of that puppet limb to move. Okay. Now what I'd like you guys to do is take a few steps with your puppet, also keeping track of what your arms might be doing when they're walking. Okay, great. We got a little funky walk going on, all right? Let's see what we got over here. All right, keep that puppet up nice and straight and tall. Try, that's it, there you go. Now, when you have that tension, if you need to let go of one arm, you can do that. You don't always have to be holding both arms. Now, he's looking like he wants to lean forward. So, wow, that was a great jump. Let's try a jump. But before you do it, the problem with that last jump, which was great, but the next step that you want to add to that jump is you need something before you jump. What do you do? What?
You bend down a little.
You have to bend. You have to bend down to go up. And really, you always have to prepare a movement from the opposite direction before you go. So like if you're going to take a step, you have to lean back so you can release that leg before you step. When you jump, you gotta bend down before you leave the ground. And when you land, try a jump. Bend down and jump. That's it. That's it. Just hold on to those legs and you'll be able to land it. And when you land, you're gonna bend those knees too because you don't wanna hurt your back. So you gotta bend down, take a jump, and very nice. Let's try your jump. Great. They're cueing each other. They're counting one, two, three. They're finding ways to sync their breath so that they can make three people do one person. Great. We got some jumping jacks. Let's have a couple more jumps over here. One, two. It's like they're on the moon. Three. Oh, my gosh. Give them a round of applause, everybody. All right. While you guys play around a little bit, try a couple more moves, maybe a hop or a sit or a lie. We have a couple minutes. If anyone has any questions, oh, we're ready to go. Okay, we're ready to move on to our next section. I want to give you guys my congratulations and my thanks, and you, my congratulations and thanks. Let's give a round of applause to our amazing volunteers. All right, thank you so much, ladies. Have a great rest of your exciting day. Good job, everybody.
Okay. Let's give a round of applause for the Center for Puppetry Arts and that amazing experience. You all can visit them outside at the tables. We've got a special treat. There are some young women in this audience who did some commercials and prep for us prior. We're gonna watch that right now, enjoy that while we get set for your next experience. Again, we're so excited about International Day of the Girl. I wanna give a special shout out to the Women of Atlanta Advisory Council, our co-chairs, Morgan and Tamika, who are here with us. Thank you all, enjoy the commercials.
The United Nations designates October 11 as International Day of the Girl, a day dedicated to empowering young girls, amplifying their voices, and highlighting the unique challenges they face around the world. This year, we wanted to take a closer look at what it means to be a girl right here in Atlanta, so we visited two incredible schools, Coretta Scott King Young Women's Leadership Academy and South Atlanta High School, to ask girls about their experiences, their dreams, and what being a girl in this city means to them. In a city filled with history, culture, and opportunity, join us as we explore their thoughts, perspectives of the next generation of female leaders, innovators, and change makers. Through their eyes, we'll see the world they are growing up in and the impact they want to make. Stay tuned as we amplify their voices, celebrate their power. Now join me in igniting their future.
Most about being a girl in Atlanta is having the opportunity to attend a school that focuses and teaches the true meaning of leadership, blossoming into individuality, and being a part of a strong community.
During the summer, I get to intern with the mayor and focus on my other extracurriculars, which include cheerleading, health care occupation, and the Hornets Buzz news broadcast at my school.
One of the things that I have been most proud of would be the big step to coming to middle school. Around the end of summer, I've been really nervous because I've seen videos on what not to do, what to do, and really it was just bothering me. But I put my foot down and I persevered. Then and there, I realized that not everyone can stay positive no matter what. And so I just asked my older friends if they can help me out and knew that I would ace this year.
Last year when we did our Black History program, I got to perform in front of hundreds of parents and students, and it just made me feel so amazing.
A time that I felt proud of who I was during my eighth grade graduation when I received the title of valedictorian. When I heard those words, my world just lit up at that moment, and I was so happy. My mind went back to the time during that school year where I spent my time studying and really indulging in my studies.
I went to France by myself for the summer, so I stayed with a host family, and I engaged in French speaking, no English. My host parents didn't understand any English, so I think I just established my independence more, trying to learn the transportation in a different country and just being by myself and allowing myself to grow more.
There are many opportunities I would like to see for young girls to succeed, such as mentor-mentorship programs, STEAM and STEM programs, and self-esteem classes.
I feel like society has a lot of stereotypes that bring us apart, and having more clubs and activities will bring us closer together.
I know at my school I've been trying to advocate for a greater sense of community and sisterhood, so just continuing mentorship, but having long-lasting mentorship, so it doesn't stop at just high school. Those people will continue to be with you for however long you need them.
My dream for the future is to potentially become a child psychologist.
I also dream about world peace, prosperity, and unity, because there's so much violence going on in the world, and I think that most of it is unnecessary. Part of it is because we're so busy trying to hold each other down instead of lifting each other up, and then we can start heading in the right direction to make the world a better place.
Right now, I want to study psychology and then go into the field of obstetrics and gynecology, and I feel like I would best achieve that by getting a mentor who wants to go into a similar field who has done that before, so they can tell me like the journey and what type of steps I need to take.
As a 12th grader, I will be leaving home soon, so my local community, school, or government can help me by exposing me to skills such as like life skills or skills that pertain to my desired career field. Like, my community can help by establishing workshops that engage us in financial literacy, or like STEM workshops that cover certain concepts like coding or data analysis. My school could help by establishing networking events so I can connect with other women in the field that I want to go in. But my local government could also help by establishing more internships and summer jobs for the girls in my community, and this can help with our employability skills.
I would like to see more art schools included for young girls who want to pursue an art, or anybody who has a dream to be an artist. I feel like being an artist is not taken as a serious occupation for anyone who wants to pursue in it, and they are usually not pushed to succeed their dreams. More art schools will help people understand that you can pursue an art and you don't have to drop your dreams and talents and leave them as hobbies as an adult.
I believe that there are like many significant and present issues that affect girls in Atlanta today, and some of which have been occurring for decades now. One prevalent issue that I can say is sexual crimes like sex trafficking, sexual assault, sexual harassment, and things like that. Because as you know, Atlanta is home to one of the most, if not the most, busiest international domestic airports, known as the Hartsfield-Jackson International Airport. And with that being said, there is a lot of traffic that goes on within that area.
Social media. Especially because us being teen girls, of course we have social media. And looking at social media, people post any and everything on there, which can cause things like comparison to others or feeling down about not having certain things, which can cause a downfall in mental health.
I believe that it's like kind of a shame that like girls at sometimes can't even feel safe in their own community, in their own home, because they have to be on their P's and Q's about these types of things.
Like, I can't even walk to, like, my local convenience store during the evening or at nighttime without having to be on high alert and being cautious of how I carry myself. And I think that's truly sad. And we should continue to strive for it, to change that for women in Atlanta.
A woman who I admire in Atlanta would be my mother. She is a very educated woman and really inspires me to do the same. I can always come to her when I need advice, and she always introduces me to the many diverse cultures of Atlanta.
I would say Stacey Abrams. I admire her for her ambition and her want to represent women of color.
I represent the hopes and dreams of little girls like Atlanta's first female mayor, Shirley Franklin, Takesha Lance Bottoms, who grew up to be great leaders, help improve the landscape of Atlanta. These women are paving the way for girls to do anything they set their minds to and be the best version of themselves. This inspires me to do anything that I set my mind to and to never quit, never back down, and never give up.
If you'll hold for just a second. There we go. What an amazing experience. Let's have every girl who was in that video stand up in this audience. We want to see you, cheer you on. Thank you so much. What an amazing experience. Thank you all. We are so grateful to each of you. We're about to jump into a panel conversation, and I'm so excited about this. And so maybe you want to stretch yourselves, stand up, move a little bit, because we're going to get our panelists settled, and then we're going to get into some amazing conversation. So take a moment, get yourselves ready. Panelists, come on up and join me. Layla, why don't you sit here? Yeah, perfect. Yep, and Karen, yep, perfect. And I think we're going to bring out some microphones for our panelists. So we're going to give our team just a second. Y'all are seeing live in-studio production. This is how it works. So you see we're changing backdrops. We're doing all kind of things. It doesn't matter. Oh, okay. All right. Perfect. All right.
Thank you so much.
Maybe, Bria, why don't you pass one down to this end and we'll get started. And y'all hold that one down there. And I think maybe this is giving me some backup. We're also going to test my lavalier and see if it works. Am I still? Okay. I guess I'm going to use this handheld. Again, it's all live. Perfect. All right. Thank you to the GPB crew. Y'all give them a round of applause. They are making it happen. All right. So you all met me earlier. My name is Candace Stansel. Again, it is my gift to serve as the Chief Equity Officer of the city. Some people are probably like, what does that mean? It means I get to make this city work for everyone. That's literally what I spend my days thinking about, whether it's girls in this room, folks with disabilities, folks from the LGBTQ plus community. Last night, we had a big event celebrating that community. So our goal is to make this city work. So if you ever need anything, feel free to reach out to us. And now I'm going to let the panelists introduce themselves by answering a quick question. And they're going to tell you about, even as they introduce themselves, a time they felt most proud of who they are. So say your name, and then tell us a little story about that. We'll start with you, Layla.
Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Layla Shannon. I am a junior at Drew Charter School. And to answer that question is kind of hard, because to answer a time where I've been proud of who I am, I have to define who I am. And that's really hard as a high schooler, because I'm 16 and I have a lot more life left to live. I can talk about times where I can be proud of my academic achievements, but I do know that I want to learn and grow to become a person outside of academic accolades.
Nice.
Because I'm more than that. I can talk to you about how I went to Harvard over the summer to debate in an international competition.
Come on.
I could talk to you about how I interned at Georgia Tech to teach students how to do AI curriculum.
Okay.
But those things are just things on a resume. And as a person, I know I want to grow and become someone more holistically. So I'm still figuring out who I am. And that's a little bit about myself.
Who are you? Who are you? Where are your parents?
Her mommy's over there.
Hey, everybody. My name is Karen Graham, and I'm a former news anchor here in Atlanta. I worked for Good Day Atlanta for about 10 years, 20 years at Fox 5. Born and raised here. I'm an original. Went to Frederick Douglass High School. Whoop, whoop. Astros? Astros? Yeah, I love that. Hey, Astros. I'm currently the creator and co-CEO of Sign One News, Sign One Studios, which is a global tech production company that provides news and information for deaf and hard of hearing viewers all over the world. But also, we are the liaison between the hearing world and the deaf world, in that we provide language access for deaf and hard of hearing members of the community. And just like Layla, that's a hard question to answer because I'm proud of the fact that I set goals. I have challenges. I have events like this. There are encounters that I have. And I'm proud when my mission is served.
Nice.
for that moment. Mm-hmm. And so I'm setting goals by the hour. So I'm proud that I did something. Most recently, in real time, I flew to Montana and hiked a 6,000 elevation foot mountain.
Wow.
Just because I wanted to. And so that was a challenge that I had. I set that goal. I did it. I'm proud of that. I'm proud that my clothes fit today. you know,
yeah, day to day,
I'm
day
having
to
a
day.
Good day, good hair day today. I am proud of that. And I'm proud mostly that I was obedient when God said, start this network. And I said, are you sure you got the right person? And he said, yes, I do. And so even though there have been lots of ebbs and flows and ups and downs, this has been the most challenging, frustrating, exciting, thrilling, fulfilling thing I've ever done in my life. I'm most proud of the fact that I was obedient.
Nice.
And then I have to follow up after that. All right. My name is Bria Janelle. I am a sports media talent and in-arena host for, I think, some of the best franchises in all of professional sports. I get a chance to be the voice of the Atlanta Dream, which is our WNBA team right here in Atlanta. For Notre Dame football, and as well as Overtime Elite, if anyone's ever been to OT, I do OTE, and the Chicago Bulls. So I feel like I have some of the best franchises that I get a chance to be the voice of and really represent. I think the thing that I'm most proud of, I would say, is I was fortunate enough and blessed enough to be mentored by Dr. Maya Angelou when I was in college. And yes, this is a long story. I'll spare you all the details. But she was my mentor up until she passed away. And one of the things that she told me when I was a sophomore during our interview is that my voice would have the ability to change nations. My talents have taken me all around the world, literally emceeing to doing, you know, being on the top level in sport. But one thing that people always tell me is, like, I may have, you know, turned on the TV and I heard your voice before I saw your face. And to understand that I'm truly living what she instilled in me as a 20-year-old kid. And now to see that, you know, my voice is what people remember me by the most, that's what makes me most proud. And, you know, I think that's just been one of my greatest accomplishments outside of being able to, you know, retire my mom this year. So I say those are two of my things that I've been excited about.
Thank you, Bria.
Wow. I wish I went first. What else is there? Hi, guys. My name is Sarah Fontenot, and I am just honored and grateful to be here with some incredible, powerful women today. Give it up for yourselves. That's amazing. To tell you guys a little bit about me, I am a podcaster. I'm a director and a producer on a platform with a man named Country Wayne. Does anyone in here know who that is? Yeah, definitely do that. And I'm an international speaker. I've literally traveled all over the world like you. You know, I've spoken in Iceland. I'm not going to lie. When I got invited, I was like, where is that? Had to look on the map. You know, Sweden, Mexico, almost every state in America, Canada. And honestly, all of that really doesn't mean much anymore. I think when I think of my biggest accomplishment, it's that I love who I see in the mirror because I'm in integrity with myself. You know, I could say how I'm proud that I moved from Canada to America by myself when I was 20 years old to pursue a dream, and it's still going, yes, that's very exciting. I could say how I bought my mom her dream car, a Cadillac Escalade, and she will not retire. I keep trying to have this conversation. But it's all of the things are great, but the experiences and the memories that you create on becoming who it is that you know God has called you to be, that for me is one of my biggest accomplishments.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Y'all, I told you we were going to have an amazing conversation, right? I'm actually going to go back to you, Layla, really, really quickly. I want to talk about what are the biggest challenges of navigating high school and preparing for adulthood, and what's been helpful during that journey?
Okay. For me, one of the biggest challenges is definitely dealing with stress. I think high school comes with a lot of obstacles, getting ready for college, getting your resume ready, getting your grades together, doing well on tests. And it's a lot, and it becomes really overwhelming when you don't know how to manage it. And I think for me, it's really important to have, like, an outlet. And I think it's important to find your passions outside of school, which is something that I'm still learning. Because one thing that I struggle with is confining myself to a box, where the only thing that is important is school and making sure that I do have a future. And I have to remember that it's okay to not know, because that's really not certain. I'm only 16. But one of the things that my dad tells me, he told me this poem, the Serenity poem, to grant you the serenity to know the things you cannot change, the courage to change the things that you can, and the wisdom to know the difference. And I think it's finding that serenity and that peace to know that it's okay. If there's a test score that I don't like, it's okay. I can work on it. I have the courage to work on myself and to reflect and do better next time. Yeah. I have the courage to go to a teacher and let them know that, hey, I'm struggling in your class and I need to know how to fix this. But what's never okay is to be stressed over things that are outside of your control, because when you can't change those things, you're stuck. So it's so important to know how to find your outlet, know how to make yourself feel better, and to just keep trying. And that's really important to me.
I figured that out when I was 30.
Right.
Right. I'm still figuring it out.
No, I mean, you've got a great head start. Yes. And I think a lot of you ladies out there have an amazing head start that you don't know yet until you get older. For us, we kind of fumbled our way into where we wanted to be, but you guys seem to have a sense of already knowing. Yeah. As I listened to that 7-minute video, where's the baby girl with the pink braids? She put her foot down. Yeah. I didn't put my foot down until I was 40. Do you know what I mean? So I'm just saying that, I see you, she's so cute. But I'm just saying that's a blessing that you guys don't even know yet. Yeah. It's a wisdom that you're walking around with that a lot of us did not have. Yeah. And so you're already 10 steps ahead, and I just cannot wait to see where you go and then what other little girls are gonna do who follow you. Yeah. That's amazing.
Karen, the future is bright, I agree. Bria, I'm gonna come to you on this one because I think, you know, Hershot is thinking about this a lot, right? What do girls need in communities? How are they getting stuff outside of the school environment, right? Hershot is really focused on golf for girls. I mean, amazing. So talk about what it means for girls to find themselves in sports, but also what other confidence and other experiences come from that.
100%. So I'll educate the audience real quick on what Hershot is. It's a golf. It's a part of my foundation. It's a golf program that I have for young girls ages 11 to 18 to make golf more inclusive and representative. So to give you context, my grandfather is the first African American to become a green jacket at Augusta National, right? And so for me, it's like I've been at the Masters since I was 10 years old, right? And I'm 35. But the thing that I didn't see was me out there, right? I would go, and when he was out there, it was just like it was a handful of us, and my thing was like, I didn't see what I wanted to become in my personal and career life, so I became her, right? And I realized in golf, I wanted that same thing to come about and happen, right? And so we created Her Shot to be more inclusive and representative for young women of color because business and golf are synonymous. So, you know, I see, you know, me being at the highest level in sports, golf is always included, whether there's a golf outing, whether there's a golf opportunity, but I don't see women that look like me there. So it's just like, what happens when you pour into and develop her earlier and you empower her and give her a sense of belonging? She's not only equipped to be in corporate America, because we are leading in corporate America, but when I looked and I saw the statistics of 24% of women in the United States play golf, less than 5% of women of color, and less than 1% are 6 to 18, when you look at those numbers, it's like, we're not represented. And so my thing was like, I wanted to create that and that platform for girls to feel more inclusive and representative. And the great part about it is we've been able to partner with PGA Reach Georgia, which is the foundation arm of the PGA America. And we do have an aggressive goal to get girls, 25 girls that were part of our inaugural program into 25,000. Because again, it's like we want to equip, we're in the year of her, the era of her. You hear her in every sense and, you know, just talking about that. And so wanting to create that platform to empower her, inspire her, because again, I didn't see people that were in my job that looked like me. And I'm like, you know what? That's what I want to do. I want to be an arena host. And people didn't really understand, like, well, what does that mean as a woman? When you go to sports games, you mostly see men. But then I started seeing, once I started 15 years ago, more women becoming that. So I'm like, okay, I did it in basketball. Now let me do it in golf. And when you have leaders, and I shameless plug, like Morgan Shaw Parker, who champion that. Yeah, I got to show love to my leader, you know, that champion that, that say, hey, listen, we want an all-female staff. We want women at the forefront of our game. So when you see the Atlanta Dream, you see her. And so I just want to take that same approach in golf for her to, you know, see herself and to be represented.
Thank you so much. Sarah, I'm going to come to you because I think you've been thinking about issues that affect girls for a long time. What are some of the things that we need to be paying attention to right now for girls? And what are some of the things that we can be doing to support them even more that you're working on?
I love that. I feel like we're in a really strange day. And there was a beautiful young lady that shared in the commercial today that said social media can either kind of cripple you or empower you. And so I think that we have to draw a line in the sand with what it is that we're subscribing to. Does everyone in here have a YouTube? Everyone in here, let me see your hand if you have a YouTube. Now, when you subscribe to things, that's the content that comes up on your page. Do we know that? So when you subscribe to a narrative from your sister or your auntie or your brother or your teacher, you're deciding to let those things come up for you all the time. And so our social media really works the same way. You have to draw a line in the sand. Are you going to subscribe and follow the people that actually make you feel good? Because a lot of the times we're following things that you might see someone that makes a lot of money, or you might see someone that looks really beautiful, or you might see someone. If it doesn't make you feel good, don't follow it. If it's low vibrational and toxic, we have to remember, guys, the media focuses a lot on pushing the negative, low vibrational things in front of us. So we have to be positive on purpose because negativity is so natural. So I would say to really focus on, if you're a young woman and you feel like you've struggled with, am I enough? I know I have. I've definitely had that. You know, growing up in Canada, I was the only melanated girl in every class that I was in. I never really felt like I fit in. And so I want you to know that if you're in that space right now where you feel like you don't fit in, I promise you when you get older like us, it feels like freedom. You don't have to fit in anywhere. Our biggest and most beautiful opportunity is to be ourselves and find our tribe. Because an eagle that is raised by chickens will think that it's supposed to cluck, when really what it's supposed to do is soar. And a lot of us in here, every single one of us in here, are meant to soar. But you've got to make sure that you're subscribing to the story that you want to see. Right? You've got to follow the things that are going to empower you, not the things that will cripple you.
Thank you so much, Sarah. Thank you. I think Sarah touched on something, Karen. I want to come to you because she talked about finding yourself, recognizing kind of the beauty and the diversity of girlhood and womanhood. I think sometimes there are these narratives that are like, this is who you should be. And we continue. She said it gets easier. It does, Sarah, get easier. But I'm much older than many folks sitting in this room. And I still have days where I have to remind myself that it's okay to love me just as I am. So it's something we learn over and over and over as girls and women. And so you thought a lot about inclusion, right? You created a network of folks who are thinking about ensuring the news is available to those who are deaf or hard of hearing. I'm also an ASL interpreter. That's actually one of the things Karen and I share a love of. And I'm curious about how you think about creating inclusive spaces, making sure all girls are represented. What are we doing to think about and celebrate the diversity of girlhood in those ways?
I think, first and foremost, to celebrate inclusivity is to seek it out. Is to realize, am I the only melanated person in the room? No, that narrative has to change. Yes. And so it actually starts from here. Inclusion starts from right here at the core of who you are and deciding that I want to open my world to as many people as I can, because ultimately I become a better version of me if I'm able to see myself reflected off of so many different people. Yes. And so when it comes specifically for Sign One News, it's interesting. I have zero deaf family members. I had no exposure to the deaf culture growing up, wow. But I got the call. And so, which I tried to ignore, to which I boldly looked God in the face and said, oh, no, no deaf people. What are you? I know you got, I tried to run from the call. But as you know, a phone will ring and ring and ring until you pick it up. Yeah. And that's what the call for me was, until finally I said, okay, God, I'll do this. And so what happened when that door opened, I then was not just exposed to a different culture, but to just different people inside the culture, to realize that the deaf world is part of a bigger ecosystem of different ability. I try not to use disability. It is just a different ability. I have deaf friends say to me that, and I do now have several deaf friends I never thought I would have, that said, there's nothing wrong with me. Yeah. I just can't hear. That's profound to me. And so when it comes to young girls, who when I look out in this audience and see just the diversity and the beauty and the energy that you're going to bring and the stories that you're going to be able to tell when your light is shined on someone else's life, that right there is where inclusivity and growth begins, is when we're able to share our stories with a diverse group of people, because that then has ripple effects across the universe. And so while you're traveling to Sweden and Iceland, Iceland, really, and even in the high school level, you're having conversations right now. We're having a conversation right now. Something you said, and you said planted a seed somewhere. Mm-hmm. I don't know when, where, who, but someone is going to take something we said in this diverse room and then spread it somewhere else. It's going to send somebody's career on a trajectory that they never thought. Yeah. They're going to hear something and go, oh, that's good. And then they're going to run with it. That's how we got here. Yes. Maya Angelou was your seed. You have an amazing mom. Oh, my gosh. And your parents. My God, the setting the examples. And that's all we are. Our life is a story that's going to set the example for the next person that we meet. Yes. So make sure that that rainbow is diverse and beautiful.
Thank you so much for that, Karen. Yes, please. We use a tool in our office when we introduce ourselves called Radically Human Introductions, where we talk about not our credentials, right? Y'all, I could run the gamut. Y'all can Google me for that. But what we talk about is who we belong to, right? My grandmother, who was one of the first Black women to register to vote in Mississippi. Ooh. My father, the first Black chief of police in Mississippi, right? Things that you come with, right, to your point. So thank y'all for sharing that. Let's talk a little bit about joy. That is the thing that I most think about in the work of equity. It is joyous because we are creating a world where everyone gets what they need, right? So Layla, I'm gonna come to you. What brings you joy? What inspires you? What keeps you going?
I got an answer to that. I have a really big plant collection. My mom's laughing. This is something that I've started to pick up over the past year. But when you come into my room, I have plants lined up all along my windowsill. It's just become a hobby, something I share with my dad, something that my mom laughs at. She laughs at my little jungle. But having those plants, like, they've become important to me, because for me, they represent growth.
They represent the human experience. When they don't have water and they're wilting, that's like us when we aren't getting enough resources. Mm. When they're wilting because of light, it's because we're not getting enough sleep. But when they grow and as they turn and as they expand outside of their pods, it just shows how people can change. Yes. And how they can grow outside of whatever their circumstance may be. And it's important for people to know that wherever that starting line may be for them, it is possible to work towards that end. Yes. And I found that in my plants through that hobby that I've picked up. So, yeah.
Thank you.
16?
Anybody else? Yeah, feel free to jump in on the joy question, y'all. Yes.
I would say the thing that brings me the most joy is something that Dr. Angela taught me. She said, he who holds the mic holds the power, or she who holds the mic holds the power. And when that mic is on, make sure you say something impactful, because people don't remember what you said, but they do remember how you made them feel, right? And so I know that any arena that I step into, whether it's Gateway Center Arena or if it's the United Center or it's, 85,000 people at Notre Dame Stadium, is if I told you to stand up and put your hand up, everybody's going to do it. So I want to make sure that I leave that lasting impression on people that they can experience, God's light that shines through the inside of me. And that's what brings me joy, is so if somebody say, man, I came into, Gateway on a Friday night, and I was beat down from work. But after that, it was so much fun. We swag surfed. We did this. We had so much fun. Like, those are the things that bring me joy, because I'm like, I impacted your day. I don't know what what you went through. So to be able to say, like, I can create and alter someone's day, to me, is what, brings me joy and makes me feel special.
I'm going to let Bria agree, because I've been in her joy in the arena, and it is beautiful and fun. And there's video of the whole thing, so enjoy that. I'm going to challenge her on that Notre Dame love, though. Go Dogs. But I appreciate that. Anybody else on the joy? Yeah, Sarah, and then maybe Karen can close.
Yes. So one of the things that I love to do and how I get into, like, my me space where I'm claiming my power every single day is I do this thing called morning vision. And so every morning, or some mornings I miss because I'm human, okay, but I journal. And I meditate and I pray and I say, I'm so blessed, happy, and grateful now that, and I speak the future as if it's now. So when I tell y'all, I will be in my room crying by myself, tears of joy, like, I'm so blessed, happy, and grateful now. I'm on my family compound and me and my mom are going for a walk and our baby's just pitter-pattering, and then my mom says, look, a wild Delilah. And I'm like, we got this whole compound and you looking at the wild Delilah, and then my baby, we stop at the garden and we eat the cucumbers and we don't even wash the dirt off, and me and my mom are talking about our nonprofit organ. I can literally see it. Did anybody see what I was talking about? Yeah. It is so real, okay? I am so in it, and then I play my playlist. I listen to my book. By the time I am showered and my makeup is on, I am filled with joy, okay? And then one of the things that bring me joy, like you, is when I see a stranger, I find something that I love about them, yeah. And I compliment strangers all the time. Girl, I love your eyebrows. Ooh, that outfit is hitting, because you never know the joy that you give to someone else just by acknowledging something that's real in that moment. People are not nice enough in 2024. We got to do better at being nicer to people, kinder to people, and acknowledging what we see in them. So those are some ways that I find joy every single day, or at least as every day as I can, because I'm human, and Sundays, just don't go that
Thank
way.
Thank you, Sarah.
That's so deep. That's my beautiful. My joys are honestly, I feel like they're so simple. They're not grand. Yeah. I like just standing in the sun.
Yeah.
I really love sunlight, and I love one of my greatest joys, weird as it is, I love watching planes take off.
Oh.
There's a spot at the airport, and for some reason, I'm fascinated by the genius of the human condition, yeah. The Wright brothers, who probably would never imagine this would happen, but I like watching planes take off. I enjoy, and you may get this, Candace, I enjoy signing, interpreting, I should say, a gift that I didn't know I had at all, and then it came very naturally for me, and when I know that I'm able to facilitate communication, that's a great joy for me, and I chase sunsets and sunrises all over the world. I have a room full of pictures of, I think God is the greatest artist, and no sunrise or sunset looks the same. Yeah. I can sit in the same spot at the same time, take the same picture, and it will look completely different. And I am in awe, like you, in awe of that. And I just want to capture that. So I will travel the world. That brings me the great joy to watch God create a mosaic in the rise of the day and at the setting of the sun. So.
Yes. We're going to wrap this up with some closing comments, and I'll just say, Karen, you're so right. One of my favorite places is to be in church. I only interpret in church, y'all, gospel songs. That's all I do. It is where I find my happy place. And so, to your point, being able to share that with someone is so special. Y'all have had an amazing conversation, and I bet there's some questions in the audience. So what I'm going to do is give some last comments, and then we'll turn the cameras off, we'll close up, and then we'll see if we've got a little time for anything that y'all want to offer in this space. Sarah, why don't we start with you, right? We're just, you know, I think the question that I would close with is there something you'd leave this room with as a piece of advice or a piece of learning that you carry with you all the time that might take them through the rest of the years, and or just a last thought?
Ooh. I would say ultimately, you have to believe in you so recklessly. And belief breaks down into 5 really simple steps. When you believe in something, that means you think about it enough. Put the pictures on your wall. Put it as your screensaver. Make a vision board. And if you think about it enough, you're creating awareness of it. If you've only ever seen a map your whole life of the United States, this is it. This is all you've ever seen. Then that's all you'll think that exists. But there's a whole world out there. So if you can dream bigger, think bigger, do that. And when you are aware of it, now you can get into action. You can reverse engineer your plan. Okay, I want to see the whole world. I want to have a bigger vision. How do I do that? So once you reverse engineer it, you can get into number 4, which is that action. Even if you get progress one day, guys, if you started journaling, you're like, I want to start journaling. And you only do it 3 months. Well, that's 3 more times than you did it last month. You celebrate yourself. Every small win turns into something big when you're consistent with it. Right? And then when you get into action, you have that progress. That's number 5. You progress. So you have to believe in yourself. You've got to think about it so that you're aware of it, so that you can reverse engineer it. Then you can get into action with it and progress to who it is and how it is that you want to be, because we're all enough.
And then I have to follow behind that. So there's an exercise, it's really quick, that I love to do. I always tell young people or anybody that I'm speaking with, turn your hands over, right? Look at your palms. The thing that God gave us that makes us different and unique is fingerprints, right? Yeah. That is the way that we identify each other, right? So if you look at your neighbors, your fingerprints and the little lines in your palms are different than your neighbors, right? And that's because we are uniquely and wonderfully made, right? So if I can give any young person advice, just as your fingerprints, right, run your own race in your own lane, at your own pace.
Yes.
So you're not looking at your neighbor. Because every time, anybody watched the Olympics recently? Okay, how many runners did you see turn to the side? They were looking straight ahead, right? That's the same thing. And when the ones that did turn to the side, barely won, right? But when you're so focused on your goal and you trust the timing of your life, my favorite Bible verse is Isaiah 60:22. And it says, at the right time, I, the Lord, will make it happen. So don't ever try to rush your process. You got to put in that 10,000 hours, right? I went from being in 2008, the intern of the Atlanta Dream, to now for the past, this is my 4th season, being the voice of the Atlanta Dream. It didn't come overnight, right? This is 2024. So I had to trust the process in my life and understand that, you know, with God, all things are possible, right? And so whatever you want, set that. No goal is too big for you. Set your ambition to that and go for it. But take your time and run your own race in your own lane at your own pace. That's what's going to make you truly successful.
How many of you have heard the saying, write the vision?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Write the vision and make it plain. Kind of tying into what you said, Sarah, I'm a goal setter and I'm a dreamer. I'm a journaler. Mm-hmm. And so when I was about your age, roughly, I've been keeping journals forever. I wrote, I want to be in the box, that little TV. I just want to be in the box. I didn't care what I did. I just wanted to be in it. And somewhere down the road, I ended up in the box.
Nice.
And so what I have here are journals that I have. And those little blue tabs are dreams that came true.
Ooh.
Just this book alone. And in it are just, I'm dreaming and envisioning
blah, blah, blah.
Yes.
And so I'm encouraging you, don't just think about it. Write it.
Yes.
Write that vision down so you can see it in front of you at all times. In this book, May 15th, 2011, I wrote Sign One News. I didn't even know what it was going to be. I just wrote what I think I wanted to be, and I left it alone. And here, now, 10 years later, I went back and read it, and I went, oh, snap, this is exactly what I wrote down.
Yeah.
And so that's why I believe in goal setting, writing your dreams down, and then going back and checking them off. And so for that reason, I have on my phone, it's a free gift for everyone here. It's a QR code to write your dreams down. If you want to start, and this is for the 8-year-old and the 80-year-old who may be in the room. It's not collecting data, it's not collecting information, it's just a gift so that you can start writing your vision. And you will be shocked
yes.
at how many of those dreams come true.
Yes.
Thank you, Karen. Layla, I'm coming to you for the last word. I mean, you are closest in age to folks sitting in this room. What would you have them be thinking about? What's your piece of advice or perspective to them?
This piece of advice is for those who aren't really sure what they want. It's okay to not know.
Yeah.
Whether you have that dream, you just don't know how to get there, or whether you don't know what you want to do at all, it's okay that you don't know because you're still growing. You're still a child, and you deserve to live that youth. So don't ever feel like pressured to conform and grow up to be older than you actually are.
Come on.
And there is always going to be a path. You just can't see it yet. So it's really important to take things one day at a time, whether that day look like figuring things out with your teacher to get a better grade on a test, or applying for a program that you really, really want to get into. Whatever it may be, just know that whatever happens, whatever your future is in store for you. And it's okay for you to not know that. And it's okay for you to be still discovering your identity and to still be experimenting and to still have mood swings and to have your bad days and to have your good days. But it's not going to look like a linear path. And that's important as you go through life.
Nice.
So that's what I leave you guys with.
Y'all, please give our panel a round of applause. This has been amazing. Please, round of applause for all of our panelists. Thank you, thank you, thank you. You can hand it. I'm going to close this out because that is the gift that I get to do. I want to say to our panelists, thank you. Thank you for the brilliance, the wisdom, the kindness, the joy. And this has been an amazing first City of Atlanta International Day of the Girl. We have never done this before. I want to thank the Mayor's Office of Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion team. They had a vision, and specifically I'm going to call out Tahajna Spence because she saw something, she built something. Y'all got to hear from her earlier today. I only get to sit in this chair and do what I do because she does so many things to make this work. I want to thank Mayor Andre Dickens for his support. I want to thank our key partners, Georgia Public Broadcasting. Thank you for hosting us. I want to thank our co-chairs, Morgan and Tamika, representing the WNBA Dream and Coca-Cola Company. We just appreciate your support, your sponsorship. And to all the International Day of the Girl, Women of Atlanta Advisory Committee, your brilliance. I want to thank Atlanta Public School System for making sure that we had this brilliant group of girls in our building. It took so many people to pull this off, y'all, and I'm just grateful. And I'll leave us with this note. One day you will wake up and the thing that you dreamed about will be happening.
Yes.
Practice the gratitude in that moment.
Yes.
Sometimes we are so focused on what's coming. Dream about it. Hope for it. Write it down. But when you get it, remember to celebrate and to live in the gratitude of that moment.
Yes.
I get to do something every day that I love. I'm grateful to be your Chief Equity Officer, Candace Stansel, signing off. Have a great International Day of the Girl.